All rise. The Honorable Supreme Court of Georgia is now in session. Chief Justice Carol Hunstein presiding. You may be seated.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. We recognize our security for this morning, Chief Coleman, Henderson, and Trooper Chris Lewis. I want to advise everyone to turn off your cell phone. If your cell phone should go off during the session, you find yourself with a substantial problem. And let me remind everyone about timing. Each side will have 20 minutes. At the conclusion of 15 minutes, a red light will come on the front of the podium, which will let you know that you have 5 minutes to conclude your argument. At the passing of 20 full minutes, you must cease any argument. You will see there's also a clock up here on the bench to help you keep your time. Kim Motors Manufacturing, Georgia Inc. et al. Versus Kristen Coleman et al. Case number S13A1085. Russ Miller, Carl Cannon, and Claude McIver for Appellant, Gerald Weber for Appellee.
Wholly within the first category of exempt documents, and modifies only the disclosing participle clause. The qualifying language has no modifying properties or diagramming relationship to either the second or third category of exempt documents. To paraphrase Senator Winning, appellees can have their own wishful interpretation of the 847 exemption, but they are not entitled to ignore fundamental rules of grammatical construction to get there. Not only does appellees' grammatical interpretation make no sense, it makes no practical sense when looked at objectively. Appellees want this court to either determine that the General Assembly created an exception that applies to a null set of documents, i.e. records of job applicants, for a job training program that has not been announced, and for an application process which does not exist, or as duplicative, to wit, they want to say that the exemption only applies to trade secrets which are already covered under the 5018-72-834 exemption to the Open Records Act. Once this court has determined that the proper interpretation of the exemption applies to the documents in issue, this court must also find that there are no constitutional impediments to applying the exemption to the case at bar. As this court has previously held, the Article 1, Section 1, Paragraph 10 provision only prohibits the General Assembly from impairing, through retroactive application, vested rights. As this court held in Fulton County, a litigant has no vested rights in statutory exemptions or privileges. The legislature has extended the ability to review government records, much like the tax deductions in Fulton Bag, as a matter of legislative rights.
The ability to the exemption have the effect of eliminating the cause of action that existed?
To the extent that those issues are raised, those will be addressed by Mr. Cannon in the right of access to courts provision of our argument. But in this case, the General Assembly went in and said that you have a statutory exemption here. We're going to modify the statutory exemption, and it is going to apply retroactively in this case.
Prior to the legislation passing, was there a violation of the Open Records Act?
Your Honor, we would not submit that there was. There were other exemptions that were raised to the requester's documents request. Those have not been litigated.
But we have to interpret the statute as if there was a violation of the Open Records Act prior to the amendment. Otherwise, the amendment wouldn't have any effect.
Actually, Your Honor, what the General Assembly has done is make a policy determination that rather than have private entities and state agencies go through the therogenics analysis and other methods for going and convincing the trial court that an exemption exists, they've, in this case, performed a blanket exemption for certain categories of documents related to the Quickstart program that they have said, as a policy, those are clearly outside the boundaries of any reasonable expectation of the public coming in and taking a look at them.
Would you agree, though, that we would have a different analysis, regardless of what the analysis might be, under one scenario where there was a violation at the time the legislation was passed, and then a different analysis if there had been no violation at the time the legislation was passed?
For the issues raised here, Your Honor, I would actually submit that there really isn't, because for constitutional right of access, as I'm sure Mr. Cannon will get to, we're not talking about obliterating the ability to access courts, the ability to litigate a particular claim. What you're doing at that point is removing the category of law that will apply to a case of bar, not barring a litigant from coming to court.
Well, I'm concerned about a scenario where there is a violation, the statute has been violated, 3 days to provide the documents, whatever the requirements are, has been violated, there's a cause of action, you're in the process of going to court to fight it out, and in the middle of that, legislation comes and says it applies retroactively, and your cause of action no longer exists.
Well, in fact, Your Honor, that's exactly what existed in the Evans case decided by the Court of Appeals, where you actually had a case that had been through several permutations, and you actually had an entry of summary judgment against the public agency requiring that they disclose certain records. And at that point, the General Assembly went in, modified the exemption, and the Court of Appeals said that it could be applied retroactively, even though you already had a trial court order mandating disclosure of the documents, and the exemption did not exist.
I mean, Evans, and then Evans was followed once the Court of Appeals, but this court has never held the same, right?
That's correct. It appears that neither Evans nor Webb were appealed to this court. court. There's no cert denial at that point in time, and no subsequent appellate history. But the policy...
Can I stop on Justice Melton's point? If you may have some freestanding right to get documents as a citizen in this state, but then it's hard to say that that's something that you have a square right to until you actually go to court or make a request for the documents. And at that point, at least when you go to court and with a cause of action, why do you not have at least a property interest in getting access to the documents which under the existing law you are entitled to? One thing for the legislature to eliminate a tax deduction before you provide them. But if you've already, let's say you've already filed your income taxes for a year, and then the legislature says we're going to take away your deduction, do you think that's okay?
Well, actually, Your Honor, in terms of Fulton Bag, it was looking at prior tax years in terms of the payment of federal taxes and the modification on the deductibility of the federal taxes. For prior tax years, the General Assembly modified. But in this instance, you've got to look at the policy underlying the open records. These are not rights, for lack of a better placeholder description, that are derived from common law. They do not arise out of constitutional provision. They exist as a matter of legislative grace, that the General Assembly has said a citizen has the ability to come in and inspect certain documents.
What if they had gotten a final judicial order that they were entitled to the documents? Let's say they'd gone to court, the trial court had ruled in their favor under the old law, and that decree became final. But they still hadn't actually physically received the document. So you're saying the legislature could have altered the law even at that point?
If, Your Honor, if the lawyers for the public agency had not appealed the case, if that order had in fact become final, I would argue in that case you're dealing with an entirely different analysis by this court. But that's not what happened.
Why is it different if this is all just subject to whatever the legislature feels like at any time, and they can say that you're applying an exemption even after someone's gone to court?
Well, at that point, you have a binding court that has become the law in that case, and this court has a policy of trying to provide finality to those court decisions. So at that point, you can't get no more than the General Assembly can come back and resurrect a cause of action that has lapsed through failure to file a claim within the statute of limitations. This court could not, and the General Assembly could not, go back in and retroactively alter something that has become the law of a particular case. But in terms of the ability of the General Assembly to go back in and retroactively alter provisions of the Open Records Act, it's following from the policy of these are privileges that are granted to citizens. Justice Thomas, you mentioned that property interest. To be candid, there are no property interests implicated by the ability of a citizen to come in and inspect certain government documents.
Well, you just said that there is an interest, at least when they take that interest all the way and get a judicial decree in favor. At that point, they have it, you would agree, they have a right that could be retroactively eliminated.
I wouldn't concede that they necessarily have a right at that point. They have a binding court order that has become the law of the case.
It's not a right. If it's not a legal right, then I mean, you can put whatever label you want on it.
It's not a right under the Open Records Act. It is a right that exists under other provisions of this court's case law that deal with the finality of a decision in a particular case. But in this instance, the General Assembly has retained the ability to go back in and modify certain provisions of the Open Records Act when they see that there have been, for lack of a better description, omissions in the statutory scheme.
Did the complaint seek damages in addition to declaratory relief?
They seek damages for attorney's fees, Your Honor.
What's different about the open record scenario that would allow the legislature to retroactively take away that cause of action? Would the legislature be able to do that in any other type of cause of action?
Your Honor,
if a complaint has been filed seeking damages or attorney's fees as damages, could the legislature come back and say, not anymore?
Actually, Your Honor, in terms of a vested right analysis, this is separate and distinct from something that may arise from a cause of action that derives from the common law to redress address injuries to persons or chattel, or for provisions that arise out of constitutional provisions, or that impair property or contractual rights. Let's get that done. This is a matter of legislative grace where the General Assembly has said you have the ability to come in and inspect certain government documents, so that there are no property rights implicated.
Could the legislature do that, what you're talking about, with any granted legislative cause of action?
It depends on the nature of the cause of action itself. As this court held in Spengler, while it addressed the issue of Fulton Bag and found that there was no interest in preserving statutory privileges or exemptions invested, in that case you had subrogation rights, which were derivative of the common law right to address injuries in a personal injury action. And the court said the constitutional provisions that prevent the General Assembly from going back in and modifying that cause of action for personal injury would also prevent the General Assembly from going back in and modifying the right of subrogation.
Mr. Willard, do you want to say something?
Yes, Your Honor, I apologize. I need to defer the balance of my time to Mr. Kent.
Hunstein, justices of the court, may it please the court. I'm Carl Cannon. I'm representing the key events of the appeal. Let me start by saying what's different about the Open Records Act from other causes of action. Other causes of action typically involve some type of real property interest. Not real in the sense that it is a parcel of land, but a concrete property interest. What we have here is not some right that exists in any given individual. It's a public right. It's a public right. It doesn't belong to particular people. Yes, you can make an application to inspect public records. Yes, there's a provision of how the public records are to be produced to you. That doesn't give you the right to the documents. Compare it to any other kind.
But once you submit a request, and let's assume that that request is denied improperly and there's a violation, and that person has a cause of action that belongs to that person and not anybody else in the universe.
But it's not the cause of action that is the property right that being urged. It is the underlying right to inspect documents. Just because you have a cause of action to sue somebody doesn't mean that that cause of action rises to the level of a property right or any other right that is protected against retroactive removal.
What's your best case for that? Because we do have a lot of cases, and maybe they're not plaintiffs, that say a cause of action is a vested right.
To my knowledge, this court has not looked at the distinction I'm making. The court has often referred to a vested right and referred to causes of action. But if you look to the actual causes of action in those cases, they weren't public act rights come in and inspect documents or anything of the sort. They were rights that accrued or inured to the individual who was asserting them. They had value to the individual who was asserting them. In this case, in an Open Records Act case.
But this case at least had value in terms of damages. An entitlement, a statutory entitlement to damages.
Your Honor, it's not damages, it's reimbursement for attorneys.
Okay, we call attorney's fees regularly damages, and it's money. They get money.
I would submit that is not the substantial interest that's necessary to create a right.
It doesn't have to be substantial. If you have a cause of action for a dollar of property, that's good enough to have a vested right, right?
Well, it may be the case then, for example, under the Freedom of Information Act cases that we've cited, it may be the case that the cause of action for the attorney's fees approved can proceed. But the right to the documents themselves, that right is not one that is susceptible to vesting. It's unlike any of the other rights that this court has said are vested rights. It is merely a public right. For example, I request a document. I get the document. It has no particular value to me other than I can look at it because I can't sell it. I can't do anything with it because every other member of the public can get that same right.
We don't know that.
Yeah.
You know, people troll public documents all the time to sell.
And informational rights are often deemed to have considerable economic value.
those are because usually of a added quality to the information. For example, something like Westlaw, Lexis, and the like. It's not because you've got a document that anybody else can get for the same cost that you pay to get the copy.
That's really not true. It's because you go through the effort to compile it and make it available. You can make money off of it.
Now, the compiling is a wholly different thing.
When I say compile, just collect and make available. You don't have to add value to it to make money off of it.
Well, that you put them all together in one place and make them available may add some additional value.
So should we factor into that? I mean, we can get an argument about whether somebody can make money off of it, but I'm not sure we should shape our legal analysis on that basis.
I think it depends on whether or not there's a value. If you look at all the cases before that have found a vested right, it is a right in a particular individual to proceed and to profit from what he has obtained. The vested nature of the right, be it a property right for, that can't be impaired by a zoning ordinance, have to fact, or any other kind of right that has concrete value to it. I think that's a distinction. Now, this court has not addressed that distinction. I think it needs to address the distinction.
If you lose this case, if you're right on the first issue, that this exemption will apply to these types of documents, and there's no question, it seems, going forward that would be constitutional. The only case that would, the only documents that would be affected by this case are Kia's documents, right?
We don't know that. I suspect it is so, but I don't know that for sure.
Well, the only documents of which that we know a cause of action having proceeded are Kia's.
It's the only one I know of, Your Honor. I can't say for certain that it is the only one.
Thank you, Counsel.
Good morning, Your Honor, and may it please the court.
Chairman. I want to adjust that.
Oh, I apologize, Your Honor. Is that better? Good morning, Your Honor, and may it please the court. My name is Gerry Weber, and I, along with my co-counsel, Craig Goodmark, appear on behalf of the appellees in this case. Your Honors, we're at an interlocutory appeal from the denial of a motion to dismiss. And for the purposes of the motion to dismiss, we assumed that Kia's interpretation was correct, because that was the only time the constitutional questions would come into play. Those constitutional questions addressed by the trial court need only be reached if Kia's interpretation of the statute prevails. We believe it should not, and we'll begin with the statute, but we'd like to emphasize that our clients did everything that one would expect a citizen to do. They made an open records request. That request was denied. Not a single record was produced. They filed a lawsuit under the then existing law, and the General Assembly took that lawsuit, that right, away. Now, when an economic development project is being courted by the state, it's involved in two areas. One is incentives, which is now contemplated by Exemption 46, and the other is staffing plans, and that's contemplated by Exemption 47. When Governor Deal signed this legislation into law, his press release said, subjecting our negotiations to the open records law puts us at a competitive disadvantage. The theory was that other states could use our own open records law to access records regarding a then pending negotiation with an economic development project, essentially letting the cat out of the bag. And that was the concern.
Now, you know, you rely a lot on a press release about a statute. Well, it's not surprising that the governor would talk about the most defensible purpose of the statute, but applying it just a normal grammatical reading that I think if we gave it to any English teacher in a Georgia high school, I would hope they would read it grammatically. It applies not only to things that would disclose commitment, but also to the records and the identification of hiring practices. And that had the effect, along with retroactivity, of quelching your lawsuit. That is not something you would expect the governor or any other person to go out there and say, one reason we passed the statute was to quelch the lawsuit. So I don't understand how, well, first, I don't know how we'd ever attribute any effect to a press release by a single person. What about actually what the statute says?
Well, let me turn to that, Your Honor. There are five commas in this legislation. Kia interprets one comma right here to actually break up this exemption into two. We submit the exemption.
Three, not two, three.
Well, in their reply brief, it's down to two because they say there's a project exemption, which is everything above my line, and then they say there's a private entity exemption, which is everything below them.
Now, they just are attributing, that's a misreading of their brief. They are attributing one purpose to the project, and then they are attributing the other two, which they clearly say are three separate things, to things that protect private entities. So, I mean, there's three separate commas, and if you take out the one you're talking about, it makes it illegible.
Well, Your Honor, let me try to explain. If the cat out of the bag rationale is the rationale for this legislation, or if not, then one looks at the records that are generated prior to a binding commitment being secured. And we submitted a supplemental authority, which is the training needs assessment developed by Quick Start prior to a binding commitment being secured. And in that training needs assessment, the state, in conjunction with Kia, prior to a binding commitment, develops records related to training. Right here. Develops records relating to job applicants. Right here. We agree with Kia that then there aren't going to be job.
Then that comma after the word applicants, by your reading, makes no sense. If the second two clauses both modify the first clause, then not only is it bizarre to have a comma, you know, before those two clauses, it's also that comma after applicants makes no sense.
Well,
you would not write it that way to have two clauses modifying the first clause and separate the two clauses that modify the first clause with a comma.
We believe that the beginning part of the exemption, Your Honor, with all due respect, identifies the statutory home of these records, which is the Quick Start Training Program, and defines the temporal limit. There are two possible interpretations to this. This exemption, ours is consistent with the stated purpose, ours is consistent
but
with
it's
the
not
companion
consistent
exemption.
With grammar. I mean, you talk purpose and press releases, talk some grammar. The way people who read and write the English language would write the statute.
Okay. Your Honor, under Kia's interpretation, training programs are subject to a temporary exemption. Under Kia's interpretation, these training records are subject to a permanent exemption. That inconsistency does not make sense. I don't understand, and Kia has not explained the difference between training program records and training records. Now, I do understand, Your Honor, that records of job applicants, actual applications, are not going to be in existence prior to a binding commitment being secured.
Counsel, you're back to talking about purpose and how the statute operates. To get to the reading that you urge of this statute, you've got to read out of the statute the comma that follows applicants and precedes the disjunctive or. Now tell me why, under the rules of grammar, I'm mistaken about that.
Your Honor, we believe that the comma before relating begins the types of records that are actually, in fact, generated prior to a binding commitment.
And if that is the case, there should not be a comma that follows applicants and precedes the disjunctive or.
Well,
tell me why I'm mistaken as a matter of grammar.
Because
or do we just accept that the Governor and General Assembly don't know the rules of grammar?
The list of records that can be generated and are in fact generated according to the training assessment plan, which was submitted by us to this court, are records relating to job applicants, one, then comma, records identifying proprietary hiring practices, training records, skills records, or other business methods, etc.
All right, then you're missing commas. Maybe you want to spend some of your time on a stronger argument, like your second argument.
We certainly will, Your Honor. And the central question for retroactivity purposes is whether citizens have a right or a privilege to public records. This is assuming that Kia's interpretation of the statute is correct.
Actually, let me say, the right privilege thing, I looked up right in Black's Law Dictionary, it defines right using the word privilege. I looked up privilege, it defines privilege using the term right. So it's got to be something other than whether you put right or privilege on it, because
Well, I would point, Your Honor, to the Fulton County versus outdoor advertising case from 2011. In that case, this court said vested rights are, quote, interest which it is proper for the state to recognize and protect, and of which individuals cannot be deprived arbitrarily without justice. That's the definition applied by this court in 2011 in the outdoor advertising case. And in fact, in that case, there was simply an application for a billboard permit. And this court concluded that the retroactivity prohibition applied in such a way as to not take away that mere application for a billboard permit. Any citizen could have applied for a billboard permit just as any citizen could request a public record. Now, the appellants rely essentially entirely on the rationale of the Evans case from the Georgia Court of Appeals applying the 1989 Open Records Law. We believe there are several problems with Evans which we'd like to identify, but those problems are really only exacerbated by later Supreme Court decisions and statutory changes. Evans relies on one word in the entire Open Records Act that uses the phrase privilege. At that time, in 1989, there were other references in the Open Records Act to the word right. 5018.71 said that there is, quote, a right of access, that was the title, and then said that interested members of the public have a right to inspect. So there were more references, even in 1989, even more now, to right than to privilege. But more importantly, Presiding Justice Thompson, your decision 2 years after Evans in Bowers v. Shelton distinguished the Open Records Act from the Federal Freedom of Information Act in concluding that there is a reverse right of action in citizens to actually sue the government to prevent disclosure of records that shouldn't be disclosed. Your Honor said that unlike the Freedom of Information Act, the Open Records Act is mandatory by its terms. It says records shall be produced within 3 business days and provides a right of action within its statutory scheme. We believe that more important than looking at whether there's one reference to privilege or 2 references to right in the Open Records Law, one should look at how the Open Records Law actually functions. And how it actually functions is just what our clients expected, reasonable expectations, vested rights. They made a request. Under the law, those records shall be produced within 3 business days. They were not. Our clients filed a lawsuit 5 years after a binding commitment with Kia had been secured. And those records were not produced. And then the legislature took that cause of action and those records away from our clients.
Will you spend some time dealing with the access to court issue and personal automatic claims below, if so, to what extent?
Yes, Your Honor. In our amended complaint, we asserted the constitutional prohibition on retroactive legislation under the state constitution, which is our primary response to what the legislature did to our clients. The second claim raised in our amended complaint is a federal right of access to courts, and we believe that it's really irrelevant that the state access to courts is at least parallel. It doesn't provide less rights than the federal
rights. Of course it does, because we've held, even though you ignore these cases, we've repeatedly and squarely held that the state, that the access to courts provision you rely on, you don't rely on the state due process, which is the source of the federal right, you rely on paragraph 12, and we felt that that is not an access.
And Your Honor, this is the weakest of our arguments, and you may well be right on that. But it's ultimately our federal access to courts claim is different. And it is focused on Section 18 of the legislation, which applies the exemption to, quote, pending lawsuits. So they knew that we had a lawsuit. Ours is the only one, as far as we know. And the purpose of that retroactivity provision, Section 18, was to take away our lawsuit, a pending lawsuit. And the Open Records Act was a very comprehensive revision in 2012. But only this exemption was to be applied retroactively. Only this exemption was to be applied to our lawsuit.
Right, but it also applied to every lawsuit. It made the law apply retroactively across the board. So not only to your lawsuit, but for example, to anyone else who wants to go back and try to get these kinds of records as any other quick start applicant, right?
Sure, absolutely.
Well, but that's sure, under cases like City of Chicago, the Seventh Circuit case, and lots of other federal cases say there's only a problem with federal access to courts with a retroactive change. If you are, there may be a separation of powers case if you're focusing on a single case, but if you just change the law, then that's not an access to courts problem.
Well, we believe that for the rationale of Presiding Justice Thompson and Bowers v. Shelton, that the FOIA cases, there's two circuit decisions that the appellants cite, and they say a statutory exemption, kind of midstream, must apply. The new
are
statutory
you talking
exemption.
Vested rights now or access to courts?
Well, there's some overlap, but right now I'm talking about access to courts. Okay. And under access to courts, both of those decisions rely on the discretionary nature of FOIA, those circuit decisions from another circuit. As this court held in Bowers v. Shelton, the ORA is different from the Federal Freedom of Information Act. It is not discretionary. It is mandatory. And for that reason, we believe that those decisions are inapplicable.
Right, but there are lots of other federal decisions. What is a federal decision that says a retroactive change in law, substantive law, not procedural law, but a substantive law that applies to everybody, not just one case, is the violation of the federal access to courts due process provision?
Well, Your Honor, that is the reason that we have relied on Section 18, which says that it applies to pending lawsuits. So we have distinguished this from an exemption change, a change in the language of an exemption, because Section 18 specifically by its terms applies to pending lawsuits. And we believe that that makes the access to courts claim different from one that those FOIA cases cite to, where there's simply a change in the scope of
the what is your federal case from any federal court or state court in the country that is on point?
I have not seen, and we have searched for a case where a legislature specifically said that they were going to eliminate pending lawsuits by the terms of the legislation. I have found no case on that point. Every case since Evans, and the one case that relies on Evans, the Webb case, has referred to citizens having a right to records. And this court in 2008, in Athens Clark County versus Athens News, quoted the privilege language, the one that Evans relied upon, but then went on to say that the, quote, the Open Records Act provides for the right of citizens to inspect records.
None of those are holdings. They're just saying something in the course of deciding. Do you think we were being very precise on whether that was a vested right?
Oh, I don't believe so, Your Honor. But the every single case, both before and after Evans, has referred to a right of citizens. And look at the statute. The statute says right. All Evans does is pick out one word out of the statute, privilege, and say that means that there's a privilege. But in point of fact, even in 1989, there were two references to rights of citizens.
When do those rights kick in? Do they kick in when the document is given to the state? Or exactly when does the right kick in?
We have said that it's one of two positions. Under either of those, we would prevail. Either 3 days after the request is made, the three business day, there may be a vesting there. But in any event, there's a vesting when one actually files a lawsuit. So I'm not sure, but for the purposes of this case, both of those happenings occurred well before the legislature attempted to take away the rights of my clients.
So they don't actually vest. I mean, even though I have a right now to go get some records, you say that right hasn't vested until I exercise it.
I believe that that's correct, Your Honor. Because one has to assert a right to have an expectation, in the words of the outdoor advertising.
And in your view, would Evans need to be overruled or distinguished?
Well, Evans was applying the 1989 Open Records Law. And it was prior to Presiding Justice Thompson's decision about it. So I think it could be overruled or it could be distinguished in either event. It's no longer good law. Your Honors, in the end, $16 million of taxpayer funds were extended by the state for a facility at the heels of Kiev. Now, we are not saying that many of the records that we've requested might not be subject to an exemption. That is an issue to be addressed on remand. There were many exemptions asserted by the defendants under the old law.
Can I ask you one other question? Does Kia have a vested right, having provided its records to the state with under a, an existing legal framework, does Kia have a vested right in the application of the old statute?
Absolutely, Your Honor. And actually, Bowers v. Shelton speaks to that because it allows for a reverse open records lawsuit, unlike the Freedom of Information Act, it does not allow for it. And the site acquisition agreement in this case allowed for, or first allowed for Kia to get notice and then to assert its rights to say, hey, these documents should not be turned over because an exemption applies. We did not contest their intervention in this case because they have that right. And they can assert on remand that the old exemptions can apply to some of the records. But that is an issue for remand. We're just at the motion to dismiss stage at this point, Your Honor. Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you, counsel. Related cases on the calendar next. We have Julie Gibson Taylor with James R. Taylor, case number S1A0911. Julie Taylor versus James R. Taylor, case number S13A0912. Miles Rich.